Good evening. Glad you're watching. We'll start at 6 o'clock with our church prayer meeting. Ash and Marie, glad you're watching. Start at 6 o'clock. Hey, Sally. Say, Gabe, it's hard to see. Welcome. One minute away, y'all, and then we'll get started with the Wednesday night prayer meeting. Hey, Sal. Go and get your coffee and or a bottle of water. Get your Bible. You're gonna need your Bible for sure. Hey, Alan. Beverly, welcome. We're gonna start any second now. Hey, Beverly. We're going to be in Luke chapter 22 tonight, so get your Bible. And again, if you want to get a cup of coffee, we're going to get very serious with prayer. Start praying right now and thinking of who you want to pray for tonight. We'll probably let the song play out and then we'll get started. Let's worship. That's right. Give me a thumbs up, y'all, if you can see the picture and hear me okay. Give me a thumbs up. Thank you. Open your Bibles. We're going to be there soon. Luke chapter 22, verse 39. I'll turn this down, but we got to worship first. Powerful song. Jesus, no doubt, is everything to me. Just listen to the words. Worship with me. Now, going to open up with a guitar tonight. Just listen to these words. It's more, Jesus is more than just the words. He is the Word. Listen. Hey, Sonia, we're about to get started. Let's get our minds right. We'll start focusing on the Word. Start focusing on prayer. Who needs prayer? Your family, at your church, at your job. Hello, wife. Glad you're watching. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Ensley First Baptist Church prayer meeting. Before COVID-19, before every human being on the planet had to deal with this and go back to our corners, back to our homes. We met at this church on Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock. And our goal throughout this was to continue with our normally scheduled service, except of course, Facebook Live, because we're not coming up here for the time being. As for when we'll come back, Ron and Judy were asking me about that this past week. We are following closely the leadership of the county, the medical directors. I'm listening to Travis Tompkins, one of our church members, who's an emergency manager. And we're just basically trying to be careful. Those that are elderly, I'm getting close, and those with underlying conditions, such as myself, this has been a good thing for many reasons. It's helped us to protect those that we love. We don't want to lose anybody over this issue. And it's also helped us get the gospel out. Hope all of you know by now that Bob Murphy is back to teaching on Facebook Live through the Gospel of John Tuesday mornings. He did last Tuesday, and he will be going forward, just like we always do up here. And then on Sunday morning, Gary Grimes is teaching his adult Sunday school class at 10 o'clock. And I preach / teach the sermon, the 11 o'clock hour. And thank you, Mindy, and my family, and those who have been helping me with a little bit of worship music before we get started. All of those, by the way, I'll put it in a link at the top of the page, are available. They're available at ensleyfbc.org. You can find our sermons and everything that we do live. We put it on our sermon page, so if you miss one, you can go back and catch it. So I'm so glad y'all are here, and what we'll do is encourage you to share this when we're done, and we want to get this out to as many people as possible so we can pray with them. And even more importantly, we want to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with as many people as possible. This little church has reached somewhere over 4,000 people since COVID-19 sent us all home. And I give God praise for that. Amen. So, other announcements. Keep Chris Floyd in your prayers. Chris Floyd, I got a call from his mama. And he is not doing better. They've moved him to another facility, and he's still on a breathing machine. And so we need to, he's one of ours. He has pneumonia, does not have COVID-19, but his life is in jeopardy. And so pray for Chris. What I'm going to ask you to do, even through the study tonight, is start typing in names that come to your mind. We don't need to wait till the end. Go ahead and put the names up so people can see them, of people that you want prayer for. Or maybe you want to do that as well during the time of prayer, which we will do at the end of this. So I want to encourage you to be asking the Holy Spirit to help you pray, to help you know who needs prayer. And church, you're doing a great job of communicating with each other, looking out for each other. And let's be praying for each other. I'm going to bow my head now, and you bow your head with me. And let's open our Bible study in prayer. Again, we're going to be in Luke chapter 22, verse 39 through 47. Luke 22, 39 through 47. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name. And we give you praise, Father, this evening. We give you praise. We thank you. Help me, Lord, to pray. Help my mind to be right, my heart. Please forgive us of our sins. Let's praise him together, church, like we do. Jesus, we love you. And we praise you. Hallelujah. We ask, Holy Spirit, that in every home, from every person that's watching this, Lord, that they would say that same prayer. Holy Spirit, fill us, take over, teach us from your word. I can't do this without you, Lord. These are not just words. I'm calling on you, Holy Spirit of God. Please help us to learn your word tonight, to go to that place just before the cross where Jesus had that very difficult prayer meeting with you. Help us, Lord, tonight as we go into your word. We'll be careful to praise you in all things. And all God's children said, amen. Now, like I've asked you to do, as we're getting a little more used to this, please hit the emojis, give me the praying hands, give me the amens, and let's dialogue together. It helps me tremendously when you do that, because as you know, if you come to church here, you know when I preach, there is hand raising, there is amens, there is praise God's, there's all kinds of dialogue happening as the Holy Spirit works. And so I don't just want to speak to you. I don't want to just pray at you. We're asking the Holy Spirit to take over. And again, please dialogue with me. We come to the garden tonight. We come to the garden tonight in Luke chapter 22, verse 39. Jesus in the garden. He was marching to the cross, making his way to the cross for us. And so I want you to give me a thumbs up if you like to garden. Vegetable garden, I guess flower garden. Give me a big thumbs up if you like to garden. Maybe you have a brown thumb. And it's not that you don't like to garden, but maybe you're just not good at it. You can give me a thumbs down or a frown face or whatever you want to do. But how many of you like to garden? Well, think about this for a minute as we try to gather our own experiences in gardens. Maybe it's a beautiful flower garden up in northern Michigan. They have the tulip festivals and they have flower gardens everywhere. Think about gardens that you've been in or worked in. So when I was a kid, my mom and dad, my grandparents would put in gardens, and my mom and dad would drag me out there to pull weeds. And wasn't a big fan of a garden when I was a kid because I was pulling weeds. And I probably whined, to be honest with you, I'm sure I did the whole time. I probably whined nonstop. And for what? What was the purpose of doing the garden and pulling weeds? Why was I out there working in a garden for vegetables? I mean, really, what kid likes vegetables? So to me, it wasn't a win-win at all. It wasn't a win-win working in the garden. But I'm older now, and I've had the privilege and blessing to be able to plant my own garden, and it's a different ballgame now. I really do enjoy it. I enjoy when it works. I've had gardens that just didn't work out good at all for me. So I'm a big fan now. So, bad things can happen in gardens, right? Bad things can happen. Very good things can happen in gardens. Are you transitioning with me here? Adam and Eve, for example, who can type in the chapter, the book and chapter, where, well, mankind fell? Who can type that in? I know there's a delay, I'm told. Mindy told me there's a delay, so I'm going to give it a few seconds. Who can share with me that first garden, the Garden of Eden, which chapter, which book and chapter was the fall? There it is. There you go, Sally. Genesis 3. You think about creation in Genesis 1 and 2, and everything was perfect. Adam, prior to the fall, was a sinless man. Think about that. Eve, prior to the fall. It's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. Hey, Amy. So, we're in tonight, Luke. Those of you that are just joining us, chapter 22, verse 39. We're talking about two gardens, but we're talking about, first of all, Eden. And in Genesis chapter 3, who showed up? The snake, the serpent, Satan, the deceiver. So bad things can happen in gardens, and the worst thing happened. We sinned against God, and I'm convinced that if it were you or I in that garden, I'm convinced because of our nature, we would have done the same thing, sadly. So Jesus made a decision in the garden that he went to many years later. He made a decision in a garden to crush that same snake, to crush him in a different garden. And tonight, we go back to the garden, back to the garden. Now, we're in Luke chapter 22, as I've mentioned, verse 39, and let's get this going. Get your pencils, get your Bibles, get your prayer heart filled with the Holy Spirit. Let's get our minds right as we work through this. We're asking the Holy Spirit of God, though we cannot even come close to grasping all that Jesus went through for us, we at least want to attempt to go through that journey a little bit with him as he entered the garden. And he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. Now we know that that was Peter. Say it. Type it in. Peter. Who else? James and John. Hey, Jan. Hey, Shirley. Glad you're watching. Peter, James, and John followed him, followed Jesus into the garden. Now I want you to mark down these verses, and I'm going to ask somebody to type them in. Matthew 26, verse 37. This account is obviously in other gospel books, gospel writings. So somebody type in Matthew 26, verse 37. And also Mark 14, 33. So we know Jesus went into the garden. With him came his inner circle, if you will. Hey, Brian. Came in his inner circle, Peter, James, and John. We come to verse 40. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. Jesus had made it to the location where he wanted to leave them. He instructs them to pray. I'm confident that Jesus wants us all to be in steadfast prayer. Steadfast prayer. Now, in Matthew 26, you can mark this down. These are also supporting verses for this. Matthew 26, mark it down. 39 through 44. Matthew 26, 39 through 44. And Mark chapter 14. There you go. Thank you for helping me with those verses. Mark chapter 14, verse 37 through 41. That's Mark 14, 37 through 41. We're not going to turn there, but I want to give you this information so you can follow up and you know, look in these other gospels and study for yourself. We find three times in those passages, three times Jesus, he prays three times, and he keeps coming back to Peter, James, and John. And what does he find Peter, James, and John doing? Snoozing. They were sleeping. He finds the three men not praying, rather sleeping. Now, let's not beat them up right now, because Jesus had been warning them. Things were certainly out of routine. They were, I guess they were always out of routine hanging out with Jesus, because he's healing the blind, giving hearing to those that couldn't hear, raising the dead. But they knew something was up. It was a dark moment. it was basically Satan's hour beginning, about to begin. They could feel it. They were sorrowful, and then they're nodding off to sleep. Three times. Jesus' prayer directive was precise to them. It was precise. Pray that you may not enter into temptation. Pray that you may not enter into temptation. That should be our prayer all the time. That said, especially when we know we're about to go into some spiritual battle or some difficult situation in life, we need to be in prayer and not physically or spiritually sleeping when we should be praying. I mean, there's a time to sleep, don't get me wrong, but there's also a time, really a praying without ceasing time, a time to get real, to get serious, to pray for sure. Before we go any further, I want to pull back in my Bible to Matthew chapter 4. Mark it down, Matthew chapter 4. This isn't Jesus' first go-round with spiritual darkness. In fact, early in his ministry, I'll read to you from Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, basically. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of who? The devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. Wow, that's not an understatement, but you think? I mean, 40 days with fasting and praying. And why did he do that? Because he knew that battle was coming with darkness. Here he is in the garden, fast forward toward the end of his ministry, just before he goes to the cross, and he knows he's got to be praying. He'd been praying all along, but he knew that the rubber was meeting the road. It was time. It was on. The war was about to happen. And his greatest decision, really some say, one of them being McGee, that the victory was ultimately won on his knees in the garden before he went to the cross, where the decisions beyond time and space were made. Praise God. Have you ever been sleeping when you should have been praying? Huh? Give me a, it's not a comfortable thumbs up, but give me a thumbs up if you've ever been sleeping, maybe physically or just spiritually dull to the surroundings when you should have been praying. And then what happened is the darkness came on you and you lost that battle because you weren't prayed up. Jesus is getting prayed up. He's trying to get the disciples prayed up. And they were just struggling in the flesh with everything that was going on. And we've all been there. Pray you don't yield is what that means. Pray you don't yield or give in to temptation, Jesus is telling his disciples. Now in the model prayer, we know it says deliver me from or deliver us from what? Temptation. We should be praying that every day. Why face a spiritual dark battle that we don't have to face? There are, how many of you believe with a show of hands, how many believe there are angels? We're going to see an angel minister to Jesus here in a moment as we move through. How many of you know there's angels? Give me a, all you got to do is type in hand or hit the hand emoji. Raise your hand if you know there's angels. And we should be praying because that's what gives the fuel. Read Daniel chapter 10. That's what gives the fuel to the angels to battle for us in the unseen realm, the place we can't see but we know is there. So in the model prayer, deliver me, Jesus, from temptation. And Jesus knew this was a dark moment in the garden, not Eden, Gethsemane. And he's there. He knew he needed prayer. And the disciples were given in to the flesh. And again, I'm not picking on them. We probably would have been much the same because we've all at times dropped the ball and were either physically or mentally or spiritually sleeping on the job. And then we were overtaken by the darkness and we made bad decisions. So we're right there in that same boat. And we ask God to forgive us, but we should learn from them and from our own mistakes to pray all the time. But especially when you sense you're about to go into a spiritual war, a spiritual battle. If you're a born-again Christian, say amen if you know what I'm talking about. Let's see what Dr. Luke shares in verse 41. Verse 41. Take a coffee or a water break so I can as well, if you would with me. All right. Verse 41. Here we go. And he was withdrawn from them about... how many used to throw rocks? And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast. I guess that depends on how strong the arm is. And kneeled down, so he was, I don't know, he was somewhere between 50 and 100 yards. Kneeled down, and then he prayed. So picture it, get the mental image in the garden. It's dark. It's not only dark, but it is spiritually dark. And the apostles are praying, they're sleepy, and Jesus goes off about a stone's throw, let's call it 75 yards away, and he begins to pray. And this is the most intense, I believe, I could be wrong, but this is probably the most intense prayer meeting Jesus had in the incarnation, in his flesh. The most intense prayer meeting, because he is literally hours before the cross, before he that knew no sin became sin for us. Okay, are you with me? So that's verse 41. Facing the dark hour, he wanted those in his inner circle, those closest to him. He wanted them there, close, but still at a distance. He needed time with his Father, with Abba Father. He needed that alone time, but yet he wanted his people close by. Church, that is such an example to us. You need alone time with Jesus every day, and especially when you're going into those wars. But you also need the church family close by, at a phone call away, at a drive away. We need to be tight. We need those closest to us, those that we can count on. There are people that you should have, that I have. There's a list that I, and it's a smaller group, but man, I know they got a direct line to Jesus, and I'm calling them like, can you pray for me right now? And they do. And so we need that. We need that for sure. And Jesus had that going on. He wanted to be alone with his Father. So who do you want to be close by in the last hours? Let's say this is the last hours of Jesus' life, right? This is the last hours of his life in the flesh. Of course, he knew he was going to rise again, knew he was going to live forever. But the deal was, he was about to do something involving our sin that had him burdened like never before. Something that would make a difference in his relationship with his Father for those moments. So let's say you knew that death was at hand. Let's say you knew that the hours were near and there was no denying it anymore. We try to pretend like that couldn't happen and we try to block that out, but the reality is, yes, it can happen. And let's say that was the case. Who do you want closest with you in that time? But most of all, even when you get those that you love that are closest to you, and if you know you're going to cross over that line through death's door, you definitely want those that are closest to you, especially those that are born-again believers. But ultimately, the one you want to communicate with before you cross through that door is who? The Lord Jesus Christ, our intercessor to the Father. Jesus Christ, the only way to the Father. Jesus Christ that loves you, died for you, rose again. So we should seek the Father through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. If you think about it, by the way, on that illustration, all of our days, mark these verses down and somebody type them in for me. All of our days are numbered. Now, whether a doctor tells Jeff or not, Jeff, you've got 3 months to live. Even if that doesn't happen, do I really know that I have 4 months? Do I know that I have 4 days? Do I know that I have 4 seconds? No. And the Bible teaches, and we've covered some of this in the past several weeks, And Psalm 90, mark it down. Somebody type it in so they'll have it for the study. Psalm chapter 90, verse 12. Psalm 90, verse 12. You'll find, we learn in all these verses, the brevity, the shortness of life. Our days are numbered. Hebrews, mark in Hebrews 9, 27. I think in there you find that, that it's appointed unto man once to die, but then the judgment. And then, of course, James chapter 4, verse 14. James 4, 14, we find in James 4, 14, we find there that it's like a mist. So life is brief. Whether we've received a report that's saying, look, you don't have much longer, get your house in order, or we don't have that, we all need to be getting our house in order. We don't know the day or the hour. We'll either be raptured out of here if you're born again, or you will die. So we want to make sure that we have the believers that we trust and love, that are faithful to us, close by. But most of all, you need to seek Jesus and the Father. And Jesus was doing all these things as he's in Gethsemane, as he's just pouring out his heart in prayer. He's a stone's throw away. He kneels down. We come to verse 42 saying, he says in his prayer, saying, Father, Father, Jesus, this is the triune God. He's praying, Father, if thou be willing, this is huge. This is so huge. If thou be willing, remove this cup from me. The cup. Give me one of these emojis. You don't have to make a funny face. Just give me it. Think about it for a minute. Give me the thinking emoji. The cup. What is going on here? Jesus is asking for the cup. Let's read it again. Saying, Father, he's praying to the Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. I'm so glad the cup was not removed. I mean, this is not that cup. This has got coffee in it. But there's no way in the world that this cup could hold all of God's wrath that would be poured out on his son on the cross. I like coffee in the cup. I like some water in the cup. I don't want God's wrath on me. Thank God. Praise God. Mark this down in Romans 8, 1. When you're born again and you're saved because of what Jesus did for us, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you're saved, God's wrath will not be applied to you at judgment. Somebody should say, praise God. But if you're lost and you're watching this and you don't know what's going on and you don't believe in Jesus Christ, the wrath of God applies to you right now. Now, let me give you some scripture to back this up. For the sake of time, and I do want to get us to prayer meeting, you just mark these down. I'll read quickly if I can. I don't read very fast as it is, but we find in Psalm 75, verse 8, I'm reading from the King James Bible, for in the hand of the Lord there is a cup, and the wine is red. It is full of mixture, and he poureth out of the same, but the dregs thereof, all the wicked of the earth shall wring them out and drink them. I'm moving quickly. Mark these verses, these chapters and verses down in this book. Isaiah the prophet, chapter 51, verse 17 says, awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, out of whom have drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his fury. You have drunk the dregs of the cup of trembling and drained it out. And then in Jeremiah the prophet, chapter 25 and verse 15, somebody mark it down, please. Jeremiah 25, verse 15. You will find, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel unto me, take the wine cup of his fury, of this fury at my hand, and cause all the nations, the Gentiles, to whom send thee to drink it. It's a clear picture throughout the Old Testament of God's wrath being in a cup. And for those that are lost, that is exactly what they face. But we don't want that. God definitely does not want that. He wants everyone to repent. The lost will still drink in God's wrath, that is. Revelation 20, 15, mark it down. You'll see a picture of those cast into the lake of fire who rejected Jesus Christ, judged according to their works. Their names not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and they experience the wrath of God forever. And Jesus doesn't want that. I don't want that. If you're watching this and you've never asked Jesus to be your Savior, God wants to save you from hell. He wants you to call out to His Son, Jesus. You can't work your way. You can't do enough good things. We're all broken people. We all need Jesus, and call out to Him and He'll save you. For the saved, Jesus took in God's wrath. And He's in the Garden of Gethsemane, and He's wrestling, and He's grinding this out. And He's about to receive every bit of wrath throughout all time in one cup for Him to drink it down for you and me. And He was sinless, He was perfect, and He's doing it for love's sake, because He loves each individual, just desperately loves each individual personally. And He's taken in that because of our sin was put upon Him. So He received the wrath of God that was supposed to be for us. And He's grinding it out in the garden. And He's praying. If it's your will, Father, let this pass. Help me, Holy Spirit. You know, God sometimes gives us the desires of our heart, and we give Him praise when that happens. Read Psalm 37. And then there's other times where He knows what's best, and His will is something other than what we think. And in either case, we are blessed if we surrender to Him. So oftentimes, I get discouraged, like He's never going to give the thing I want. It seems so out there. And then I look at what's happening around this amazing church that belongs to Jesus Christ. And a dream is coming into focus called The Future and Hope. Construction is being done. And soon women are going to live here and follow Jesus and become disciples. And God's going to transform their lives. The old's going to die. They're going to become new creations in Christ. And I'm seeing the miracle before my very eyes. And it seems so vast. So many times I wanted to give up. And God said, don't give up. So sometimes prayer takes decades, folks. Don't give up. And sometimes, bam, He can give you your heart's desire. If you put your delight in Him, He'll give you your heart's desire right then and there. It's His call. And when it's His call, it's going to be awesome no matter what happens. And Jesus is grinding it out. Is there another way? Or do I got to take this cup? Remember, He was 100% God, 100% man. For the saved, Jesus took in God's wrath on our behalf. We deserved His wrath. We deserved God's wrath. For us, Jesus chugged it down. Now, this is hot coffee. I'm not chugging it. But Jesus took that wrath for us. Jesus became, as it were, an enemy of God, who was judged and forced to drink the cup of the Father's fury so we would not have to drink from that cup. Isn't that awesome? Taking this figurative cup was the source of Jesus' greatest agony on the cross. David Guzik. In hindsight, I love that it's 2020, and many people are struggling with 2020 because of all the stuff that's happening. But let me just tell you, God's on the throne, He's in control, and He's using this for His very purpose. I was telling Sonia today that, you know, I could do this if I had three baseballs. I could juggle for you. I could multitask with three. I could do two, and I could do three. You can ask. It's a true story. I can juggle. God can juggle every human being, situation, circumstance, thoughts, heart's desires, situation from past, present, and future. He hangs the sun, moon, and stars. The oxygen is just right. He does everything without blinking an eye and taking a sip of his coffee if he drinks it and doesn't miss a beat. He's got it. He's omniscient. He's all-powerful. He's omnipresent. He's God. So in hindsight, looking back this year, God's in control. The gospel's going out. You share this, so the gospel goes out. People are getting saved. In hindsight, we know he went through with drinking in that cup of God's wrath in the garden. In the garden pre-cross, the God-man was wrestling with the cup. So in hindsight, we know he did. But just think about him those hours before. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. But thine be done. David Guzik also says, a sinless man battled Satan, sin, self. Oh, we battle self. Give me a hands up if you battle self. And temptation in a garden and lost, saying, my will, not yours, be done. And the loss impacted all mankind. Who was that? That was Adam. Before, remember, we started talking about Genesis 3 with the fall. Before Adam and Eve sinned, they were in a sinless state. And Adam, the first man, sinned. And I think we all would have, and blew it. And it impacted, it gave us the sin nature. We're all sinners. That was Adam. And the wages of sin is death. God said, you will surely die. We've all been dying ever since. But Jesus gives eternal life. The second sinless man, who is that? That is Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He knew no sin. He became sin for us. Jesus battled Satan, sin, self, and temptation just like Adam. In another garden, we're talking Gethsemane night, and he won the victory, saying, not my will, but your will be done. If that's you tonight, and I would type it if I wouldn't knock the phone over, thy will be done, Father. Thy will be done, Father. And its impact from Jesus doing that for us, its impact touched people from every tribe and tongue. By the way, every nation and tribe will be in heaven, those that are born again. And so I hope that is a blessing to you, because it is to me. Because I'm a mutt and I'm thankful to be saved. I don't know what I am, really. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 6:23. We come to verse 43 of our study tonight in Luke. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. His father, not willing to remove the cup, however, he gave Jesus heavenly strength for the task. Whatever God is calling you to do. And I promise you that God, when you need it, he's given it to, I promise you, right tonight, through people praying for us, and we haven't missed a service since all this has been going on. We had a bad time just prior to and into this lockdown called COVID-19, and God has given strength, and I've experienced it so many times. When we're weakest, he makes us strong, and he gets the glory that way. And so God will strengthen you as he's strengthening his son before his son went to do what was necessary. He sent an angel. And an angel, of course, was involved in Matthew 4, we read, when Jesus fasted for 40 days and prayed before he had to face Satan that time. The angels ministered to him after that. I wonder what he ate after those 40 days. I'm thinking, man, a nice T-bone steak with a baked potato. Stop, Jeff. Focus. His father, not willing to remove the cup, however, he gave Jesus heavenly strength from on high. Let me be clear tonight. Nothing we experience could ever compare. Nothing in this planet. You might be going through, you might be watching this, and you, your family, a family member is going through hell on earth. And I don't doubt that. I don't doubt it for a minute, because I've been at those bedsides. I've been at those homes. I've been at places where families are just grieving and the tears are falling and they don't know how they're going to get through it. And Jesus gets through them, gets them through it. Those that turn to him. Some don't get through it when they don't turn to Jesus. But let me be clear, nothing on this earth, nothing we experience in this earth could ever compare with the suffering Jesus experienced from the garden to the cross. On the cross, receiving the wrath of God, the cup of God, he took God's wrath for you and for me. So that said, in a small, small way, we share in Jesus' suffering. Mark these verses down. Sally and others, you're doing a good job of typing them in. Philippians 1:29 and 1 Peter 4:13. If you think for a second you were supposed to go through this life without any suffering or trials or grinding it out in prayer and in fasting and in faith, if you think that you were never going to have troubles, you have been misinformed or you're believing a lie. The Word of God makes it abundantly clear. And when we suffer for Jesus' sake, we're supposed to rejoice because blessings follow in this life and in the one to come. He will strengthen you for your task, whatever that may be. We come to verse 44. And being, here he is in the garden. He's in agony. He's praying. Not my will, but thy will, Father. He says, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. One time I got hit in the eye, and my glasses, I think, caught me there, and blood you just picture Jesus, and I'm not going to get into the science of it. I believe it's scientifically possible. You can do that. Excellent study, but just picture it for me. Let's keep the image, and he's grinding it out, and he's praying, and the sweat looks like drops, as it were, of blood falling to the ground as he's praying probably the most intense God-man prayer that could be prayed. And God is strengthening him. And it was about to get real for sure. It was about to go down for sure. The crimson blood was falling to the ground. What can wash away my sins? Sing it. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Sing it. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That was just the beginning in the garden. There's going to be a lot more blood spilled for you and me from Jesus. Type thank you, Jesus. Take a moment. This one's worth it. If you're not typing in yet, you need to do this one. Just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We come to verse 45. And when he rose up from prayer and was come to his disciples, remember that was Peter, James, and John, the inner circle. I'm going to read it again. Somebody tried to call. Please tell the world not to call me during prayer meeting. Verse 45. And when he rose up from prayer and was come to his disciples, he found them sleeping for sorrow. I need you to pray right now. There won't be any more distractions. This is clearly not from God, these distractions. Verse 45. He found them sleeping. Have you ever tried to sleep away your troubles? They're still there when you wake up. When we go through hard times, and as I just mentioned, suffering's coming. It happens. It's going to happen. You'll have valleys in your life. You'll have mountaintop experiences. Sooner or later, you got to come down. There's an enemy. There's the flesh. We bring bad stuff on ourselves. We blow it. that we give in to Satan's temptations and we sin and we drop the ball, but Jesus will forgive us and get us back on the narrow road, right? So these things are going to happen. When we go through hard times, it seems there is options. Two for sure that Jesus gives us. The best options. Pray and watch. Watch and pray. I'm going to add a third. Fast. Have you ever fasted for let's just say a day or 3 days or more and prayed your heart out through that fast about whatever's going on? We come to verse 46. And Jesus said unto them, he's talking to them, they're sleeping for sorrow. They were sad. They were grieving. They're trying to sleep this whole thing away. Maybe this is just a bad dream kind of thing. And Jesus said unto them, why sleep ye? Rise and pray, lest ye enter into temptation. He's telling us the same thing. We've got to pray. We're about to pray in a few minutes. Jesus, please deliver us from temptation so we don't give in to Satan and the flesh. That should be one of our prayers every day. We come to verse 47. And while he yet spake, behold, a multitude. And he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near and Jesus unto Jesus to kiss him. And just like that, the betrayal. Betrayer shows up. It was time to go to the cross for you and for me. Jesus was marching forward. He had prayed. He had made the decision in Gethsemane. It, God's will, not my will. God's will, not my will. That should be our prayer. That should be our prayer tonight on everything we're about to pray for. It was settled in the garden to drink the cup. And he drank every last bit of it on the cross. Y'all pray for me as we get ready to go into prayer. Start typing in the names of the people you want to pray for. We're asking the Holy Spirit to continue to take over this prayer meeting. Pray for me about Friday night. I haven't officially made the announcement yet, but I'm strongly contemplating preaching a 7 o'clock Good Friday service. Maybe from this desk, I don't know where I'll be, but just pray, because we were going to do one anyway. So pray for me, and that God would give me guidance. Now we go to prayer. Again, I'm asking you, please, please, type in the names. You pray with me. We wanna just start thinking of all the people. Pat, Miss Pat, please, when you see these names, you can go back afterwards, Miss Pat, through all the comment sections and write those down. We keep a running prayer page at this church. So if you're watching this and you need prayer, I've already had one request before we even started tonight that came in. So if you need prayer, get your name on there. If you know of somebody that needs prayer, people fighting maybe COVID-19, people that are sick, whoever you want to start praying for, pray for. If you're a ministry leader at this church, pray for those in your team. Pray for your family. Pray for the sick. Pray for the prodigal sons. Pray for the lost. Pray for the President of the United States. Pray for the Vice President. Pray for this country. Pray for Israel. Whatever God's laying on your heart tonight, you pray with me, because it's not going to be as effective if you're just listening to me. You pray with me. Get in a quiet place and let's pray together. And here we go. You can bow your head or you can look if you need to type. Here we go. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we enter into your gates with thanksgiving, into your courts with praise. And church, as you know, or if you're watching us for the first time, we like to start our prayer sessions with prayer and praise. Praise, that is, to Jesus. So here we go. Jesus, we love you. Say it with me. Jesus, we love you. And we praise you. Hallelujah. Jesus, we love you and we praise you. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit of God, please help us pray. Please fill me and take over. Please help us to pray in the Spirit as we pray. We are seeking your face. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the ending. You're the everlasting God, and we are sinners. I hope everyone that's listening is a sinner saved by grace. I pray, Lord, that you'll forgive us, search us, the deepest part of us, Jesus, the deep parts, the hidden places. Find the sins and the thoughts that don't belong there, the actions we've done, any sin that we've offended you, that we've hurt you, that we brought tears to your eyes. Jesus, we confess these sins tonight. Your word says if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Confess your sins tonight. Whisper it. You don't need to type them in. You just do that with Jesus. And you can do that, but I would prefer that you prayed with someone else and just confess your sins and find the sweet forgiveness. And the reason we have that ability to have forgiveness upon request is because Jesus, he that knew no sin, became sin for us and died on the cross. He took the wrath of God, and it was settled in the garden that he would go forward setting his face like a flint. Father, tonight we pray for the sick, and we consider the plague that is going through the world. We are hearing signs that the prayers are working and that this thing is slowing down. And Lord, though many are still sick, and we lift them up, pray for the names, pray for the protection, pray for those that aren't able to see their loved ones in the hospital, in the nursing homes. Pray for those people in the nursing homes. Pray for them by name. Pray for the medical staff. Pray for doctors, you know. Pray for nurses. Pray for the ladies and gentlemen that clean the hospitals. Thank you, Jesus, for them. All the people, the first responders, that are all these people putting themselves in harm's way. Lord Jesus, please protect them. Put your safety around them. And Lord, help us as we distance just for a time from each other to draw closer to you and see the gospel go out, and what the devil meant for evil, we're asking that you would bring about massive good. Revival throughout the world, Jesus, please bring revival. We pray for healing. We pray for just blessings upon the sick. Say the names of people that are sick. It doesn't just have to be this COVID-19. Listen to me now. Listen to me. Let's pray for those with cancer. There is somebody that's a family member of mine that I'm very close with, that family for sure. And Mark is his name. And some of you church folks know about this. And he's in a real bad state tonight with his body. But I'm praying first and foremost for his soul, that he would call out to Jesus Christ. Because our greatest need is salvation from Jesus, to go to heaven, to be in heaven, John 14:6. I pray for Mark tonight. You pray with me. Everybody lift up your hands and pray for those with cancer. Lord, we believe that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And you make the final call. We all, as we've mentioned already tonight, we know we have an appointed time and a day, a second that our hearts will stop beating. But Lord, we're praying for Mark. We're praying for his family. We're praying for Sherry. We're praying, Jesus, for the children. We're praying, Jesus, for the extended family. We're praying, Jesus, if it's thy will be done, that you would heal him, because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are the God who created the body. You can heal the body. And you are Lord. Say this, you are Lord. He is Lord. Jesus is Lord over cancer. We have seen people with cancer involved at this church healed. And we give you praise, Jesus. Now, Lord, we know that you are able, but we also know that we have an appointed end on this side. So prepare, Lord, all of us to meet you, Jesus, to meet you, however that may come to be. Lord, we pray for the sick. We pray, Jesus, for the prodigal sons and daughters, those who used to walk with Jesus. Do not say the names under this format on here. At church, we do that. At church, we type, I don't want you to type that in. We say that at church. This is going out to a lot of people, folks. You just pray at home. Don't type in the names. For the prodigal sons and daughters. God will hear us as we pray for those. Pray for them now. lift up the prodigal sons and daughters, those that used to walk with Jesus but no longer do. And pray that God would do whatever it takes to bring them home. In this late hour, in this period of time in history, if ever there was a time that this world needs to come to Jesus, they better hurry up and do it now. You pray for by name, for those that need prayer that are back in the world. If their heart's back in the world, the love of the Father's not in them. They need to come home. They need to come running home, and the Father will run to them. He'll meet them. He's not going to beat them up. Maybe you've blown it over and over and over and over and over and over again. You come back again and he'll forgive you again. He's never going to give up on you. You come back. Jesus, please restore the prodigal sons and daughters. Maybe you feel like I've done it too many times, preacher. No, you haven't. You come back to Jesus yet again. You get on your face before God and you confess that sin and he'll cleanse you and he'll give you a new start. Now, there will be consequences. But you need to come back to Jesus, amen. And now we pray also for the lost. Lift up the lost, because these in our families and our friends in our workplace that have no regard for Christ, they've never called out to Jesus Christ, they've never asked to be saved. Listen to me, if you're watching and you've never been saved, you might be on your way to hell. You listen to me right now, that the Bible is clear and God wants to save you. He doesn't hate you. He sent his son to die for you. He loves you so much he sent his son to die for you on a rugged cross, and Jesus rose again. And the Bible says clearly, if you'll do this right now, listen to me, if you say this simple thing, I am a sinner. Oh God, I'm a sinner. And you call out to Jesus and say, Jesus, save me. Much like a thief on the cross, it's in heaven. You'll be saved in that instant, and you'll become a born-again, blood-bought, born-again Christian. Call out to Jesus and be saved. Now, church, pray for the lost. Those that there seems to be no evidence they've ever called out to Jesus, you pray for them. We want our families to be saved. We want parents to be saved, and brothers and sisters and children and grandparents. We're praying against Satan in the name of Jesus, that the walls would come down, that the eyes would be opened, that the ears would be unstopped, and people would hear the gospel. They would see that they need Jesus, and that they would call out and be saved. Pray by name for the lost. Don't put it on this page. Don't pray that, put their names on this page. You pray at home. You mark it down. We're praying, Lord. We are praying, Lord, tonight. Again, we rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus. We rebuke his work, his efforts. We pray not anywhere close to what Jesus was going through, but we come before you asking you, Father, to war against our enemy and bring victory after victory through the power of Jesus, through the power of the shed blood of Christ. We are already victors in every battle we face, every temptation that comes our way. We are watching and praying. We rebuke you, Satan. We submit ourselves, therefore, to God, and we resist you, and you must flee according to the word of God. Greater is the Holy Spirit that is in us than he that is in the world. We rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus. We pray for our country. And I don't care if you like Trump or not. You're supposed to pray for him, biblically speaking. You're supposed to pray for him. We pray for all political leaders. You pray for Donald Trump. Pray that he turns to Christ with all of his heart. Pray that he says the name of Jesus. Pray that he looks to Jesus for every decision. Pray that he boldly says that he's a Christian. Pray for Mike Pence. Pray for all the politicians. Pray for Democrats and Republicans. Pray for the city officials. Pray for the sheriff. Pray for the mayor of Pensacola. Pray for the mayor of your city. You pray for those that are in leadership. Pray, oh pray, that God would bring peace to the land. And the more time, the more Nineveh time you give us, Jesus, we are committed to sharing the gospel, to leading, hurting, broken people to you. Now I want you to pray. I want you to pray for the folks on the streets. We have a passion, a heart for the lost of our community, that those that are living in tents, that are homeless, they're struggling always and definitely now. Those of you that work street ministry, pray for the team. Pray also now. Pray, you can put the names, first name only, please. Pray for a homeless person, first name only. I'm going to pray for Roberto tonight. Roberto on Beggs Lane, I lift him up, Jesus. I pray that he'll get off the streets, that he'll be delivered through this, that he'll completely be delivered through all of this trials, that he'll have a place to live, a job, lift up the homeless, a job, a new life in Jesus Christ. Thank you for Roberto. Bless him and protect him from evil tonight. Pray for a homeless person. Pray for them constantly. Pray for the ministries. I need you to look at me now. If you're bowed, lift your eyes. I want you to pray with all your heart. And the Holy Spirit is working through me. You pray for Waterfront Rescue Mission. They are taking a heavy-duty blow. A lot of my chaplain brothers, a lot of my brothers that I worked with are home now because of this thing. And the mission is down to just a skeleton crew. The stores are closed. Pray that God would resurrect it, that Jesus would be first in everything they do, and it would be resurrected. We need a strong men's mission in this county. I need you to pray for other ministries that work with the homeless. Loaves and fishes. The opening doors, lift them up. Lift up all of them, that you can think of. Epps Center. Lift all up all the people. Pastor Brad and his church. Type it in, Sally, I'm forgetting. Pray for these folks that are working with the homeless. And now I need you to pray for a church that's not this one and pray for that pastor. Pray for a church and a pastor. I want you to pray for Dr. Null in the Pensacola Bay Baptist Association. Pray for the association, the national convention. Pray for Southern Baptist. And I also want you to pray for every Jesus Christ church there is of all denominations. Everybody that puts Jesus as the way of salvation, you pray for them and lift them up. Lift up all of our partners at streets, different denominations and churches that work with us to feed the homeless. You pray for them now. Lift up the names. Pray that the church would be strong and all these messages that are going out would get folks saved. And we pray we'll come back again. But until that time, this is a picture, if there ever was one, of the body of Christ. You pray for the body of Christ. And now, Ensley, you kind of hone it in. Ensley, hone it in. You pray for this church. Pick out your ministry that God lays on your heart. Pray for all the ministries. Pray for streets, cold weather shelter. Pray for the music ministry. Pray for future and hope, which is going to open. Oh, praise God. It's working. It's happening. The bathroom's in. God's providing. Pray for a future and a hope. Pray for the Tuesday morning Bible study. And pray for your pastor and his wife. We've had quite a spiritual warfare filled past month. And I can't get into it all tonight. But I just need your prayers. And so does Mindy and my children. And there's some unspoken, some things are on the horizon that could be good for us. We need your prayers. Frankly, I'm wore out. Need your prayers. Jesus, we love you and we praise you. Hallelujah. We close tonight by simply typing in, and I'll do victory in Jesus, thy will be done. Are you happy Jesus went to the cross? Let's do victory in Jesus. I love y'all. So glad that you watched tonight. I'm really encouraging you to share this. We're reaching people for Christ. We're reaching people with the gospel. I believe it was a powerful prayer meeting, as we always do, because we're seeking Jesus and His Holy Spirit to help us. I need you to sing at home. Makes no difference to me who's in the room. You may not have a voice now, but you will in heaven. You make a joyful noise. I don't have one. I'm going to sing loud. Oh, come on. Oh, victory. Savior, come on, forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Come on, he loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due. I love y'all. God bless you. Thank you for praying with me. I want you to know, as we close, that one of my great blessings is when you come here on Wednesday night and pray, and when we pray together like this, it gives me strength for the rest of the week. We need this, as I've said for many years, Wednesday night prayer meeting is the most important service that we do. Because if we're not praying for each other, if we're not powerful in prayer, nothing's happening. But if we are powerful in prayer, seeking God, you see the things that are happening. Amazing things for Jesus. So thank you for praying with me. That spurs me on. That fires me up like nothing else. This is Pastor Jeff. Never forget, Jesus is the way. the truth, and the life. There's no other way to the Father but through Jesus Christ. I love you, and we're out.